फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक। तो फ्रेंड्स, अभी का वीडियो है एलियंस टाइम ट्रैवल एंड पैरेलल यूनिवर्स फीचरिंग अभिजीत चावड़ा द रणवीर शो। तो चलो वीडियो शुरू करते हैं। वीडियो शुरू करने से पहले, अगर आप चैनल पर नए हो और आपने अभी तक सब्सक्राइब नहीं किया है तो जल्दी से पहले सब्सक्राइब के बटन और बेल आइकन को क्लिक कर लो ताकि आपको हमारे सारी न्यू वीडियोस की नोटिफिकेशन मिल जाए जैसे हम अपलोड करें।
अगर आपको वीडियो पसंद आता है प्लीज लाइक एंड शेयर। चलिए शुरू करते हैं।
Part one of this conversation was all about the basics of astrophysics. Part two is where we talk about aliens and deeper concepts that you have asked about on Twitter. This part is centered around most of your questions. And of course, no episode of the Ranveer Show is complete without spiritual talk. What's the astrophysics behind spirituality? That and more on this part two of a very special conversation with Abhijit Chavda. Or ask you about aliens, sir. I'm sure you've thought of this, but before I highlight aliens, we're not going to talk much about abductions. Is that something that fascinates alien abduction?
Not really, okay. Abduction, but aliens, yes, it does.
Okay. Again, another podcast topic, but here we're getting into just the introduction to that topic. So I had COVID about 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, and I couldn't work at all. I couldn't write. I couldn't create. So I just figured that, yo, let me watch as many great movies as I can. And I watched a gorgeous movie that stayed with me. It's a little heavy. I recommend you watch it. I think you'll really appreciate it. I believe it's called Arrival.
Have you seen it? I have.
It's about the communication between humans.
Linguistics.
Yes. It's Arrival, right?
It's Arrival, yes.
It's a heavy movie.
It is a very heavy movie, yes.
It's meant not for masala cinema goers. It's meant for people who think. The basic gist, without revealing plot details, is... aliens have arrived on Earth. They're possibly friendly, possibly not. And yeah, human beings don't know how to interact with aliens. Same aliens don't know exactly how to interact with human beings because there's a language barrier. Imagine 2,000, 3,000 years ago, someone in India goes to Japan. How are they going to interact? They'll say, oh, me, meh. The Japanese person will say the word for me, meh. They'll say the word for yes. Japanese person will say the word for yes. So they've shown this whole interaction between humans and aliens. Eventually, they sort of learn how to communicate with each other. They give each other names, all that. And the final kind of plot explosion in the movie is that humans realize the secrets of the aliens' language and how our language is sort of linear. Like when I'm saying, okay, so my name is Ranveer Alavadia, you are Abhijit. It's linear, yes. But aliens don't. In that movie, don't talk in a linear language. They talk in a circular language.
Yes.
Where you can read a sentence probably backward and forward. And there is a concept, sort of concept of time travel in that, in their language. And the reason aliens come down to the Earth is to show humans their own advancements in science, in language, in all this. So that's what I gained from that movie. Once I'd like to highlight what you gained again as a physicist. You're watching that movie and I'm sure it must have kind of turned some light bulb on in your head also, but obviously we'll also talk generally about aliens.
So it's a very interesting thought experiment. These movies and the science fiction books are essentially thought experiments. What if you had this sort of a situation or this sort of a dialogue between an alien and a human? So how would we go ahead and proceed and try to communicate? And what if time travel were possible? So what exactly is time, right? Is it linear? Is it circular? Is it something else? So these are the concepts that you explore in these stories. This is a new concept that was there, which I have not come across before. The linguistics of communication between aliens and humans. That's never been explored before as far as I understand. But yes, aliens could be very different from us. We are carbon-based creatures, right? Our bodies are carbon-based. The chemistry is carbon-based. You could have aliens who are silicon-based or who are based on something else entirely, right? For example, on Saturn's moon Titan, the temperature is minus 200 something degrees. But it has liquid flowing over there, which is hydrocarbons. Okay, so there could be a whole different kind of biology over there, which is completely alien to what we have. And what if that kind of situation somewhere else in some other solar system would produce an intelligent species? How would we communicate with that? Right? So that is one of the interesting questions that arises out of a story like this. But the bigger question is, do aliens exist? Right? If they are there, where are they? Where are all the aliens? How come we have seen no signs of aliens? Right? Because we have been searching. We have been searching. We have this radio telescope and all that search for signals and pulses. So far, we haven't found anything concrete, you know, like unmistakable sign of some civilization or intelligence. So that is the big question, the Fermi paradox. Where are all the aliens, right? And there are a number of, possibilities. First of all, it's possible that our instruments are too rudimentary and primitive. It's like you have a Morse code machine and you're trying to beep, beep, beep. And these guys have extremely advanced technology, right? So maybe we are too backward. We think we are very evolved, but compared in the galactic scheme of things, we are like ants, for example. Okay. I mean, if you were to explain to an ant why you have a mall and why you have all these things, the ant won't understand at all, right? You just can't get it through into the creature's brain. Mm. Similarly, there could be an enormous disparity in intelligence and technology. The other thing is that alien technology, if it is an advanced civilization, it would not leak out energy. So if you look at the Earth at night, you see it glow because the entire planet is covered with lights, right? Now that is a huge wastage of energy because the light should be directed downwards, not upwards. Mm. So we are wasting. We are extremely energy inefficient. An advanced civilization would not be energy inefficient. It would not beam out random noise into the universe, right? The communications would be very, very energy secure. So there are lots of concepts that we have to think about and lots of possibilities why we haven't actually come across alien civilizations. And maybe it's a good thing. Maybe they are dangerous. Yeah, maybe they don't want us to evolve and become advanced to their level. So that is one of the big issues in the field of research. You know?
Because you've studied the solar system this much, do you believe that there's a possibility that aliens could be a part of our solar system also and we've not explored?
See, if you look at the history of the Earth is approximately 4 billion years old. Now, we know that life on Earth emerged around 3.8 billion years ago, as soon as the planet cooled a little bit. So life just seems to have spontaneously evolved or arisen on Earth because of the chemistry, the geochemistry of the planet. And we know that Mars had a similar kind of environment about a billion and a half, 2 billion years ago. Similar to Earth. It was a very wet planet. It was warm. So why is it not possible that there could have been microbial life on Mars? Mm. And there are other planets, other moons, for example, moons of Saturn and Jupiter, where we know there are large bodies of water. Mm. For example, I think it's Europa that has a subsurface ocean. There's Ganymede that has a bigger subsurface ocean than Earth. And if the water is liquid, it means it is warm. And it means there could be biochemistry over there and it could also create life. Wow. So in my opinion, I think it's highly probable that there is at least microbial life in our own solar system outside the Earth. Mm. But as far as intelligent life goes, I don't think there's any intelligence, at least what we recognize as intelligence in our solar system. Mm. But there are billions and billions. In the Milky Way itself, there are about 100 billion stars. And in the observable universe, there are about 1 trillion galaxies. So you can imagine how many stars there are, right? 10 raised to 21, 22. So it's statistically absurd to think there is no life out there or even that there's no intelligent life out there. Mm. I am convinced that there is intelligent life out there. It's just that the universe is too vast and too empty for us to have found it thus far. Mm. And maybe we don't know how to look for it. Maybe we're not advanced enough to look for it.
Ah, wow. Firstly, wow. Secondly, I'm going to highlight, we spoke about Arrival. I'm sure you've had some science fiction inspirations in your own head. For me, growing up, I grew up in the age of video games. And I always chose video games that expanded something in my mind. If I was in a phase where I wanted to learn about football, I played FIFA. If I wanted to learn about basketball, I played NBA games. If I was in a phase where I wanted to learn about life, I started playing a video game called Sims.
I've heard of it, yeah.
Yeah, where you control a human being's life. You're playing God. You say, okay, go take a shit, go eat, go sleep.
It's a simulation, isn't it?
Yeah, simulation of life.
Yes.
Sims was a rage in the 2000s.
Sure.
And towards the late 2000s, some I think from the same Sims company, the company that made Sims, which one was it? I can't remember. But I believe it was the same company, it was someone who had worked on Sims, said that, let me take this concept of playing God into the life of a whole species.
Mm-hmm.
So human beings evolved from apes evolved from some smaller animal, the smaller animal evolved from some cell. So in this game, it's called Spore.
Okay.
It was a rage when it had come out. At least there was a lot of hype about it. The execution and the way they made the game wasn't that fun.
Okay.
So the game didn't catch on, but it opened up a lot of kids' minds.
Mm-hmm.
So Spore begins as, you start as a one-cell creature.
Unicellular organism, yeah, yes.
And you go through the process of evolution.
Evolution.
So you are in the ocean. You're a cell, one cell in the ocean. And then you have to engulf other cells. Then you become a fish. Then you have to engulf smaller fish and not be engulfed by bigger fish.
Yes,
then
yes.
You become a creature where you are an animal and you have to hunt on land.
Yes.
Then you become a tribe where there are tribes of different creatures.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to become the dominant tribe, like which is what happened with Sapiens versus Neanderthals and what's the other one? Denisovans. Denisovans.
Yes.
So you become a tribe. Then you become that dominant tribe, which is what the human species is today.
It's our story, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Then once you're the human species, you have to play a city level where you have to fight wars with other countries, which is what we're at right now, which what is probably just come out.
Earth will fight other planets. Over.
Then eventually the whole world becomes one country where you're fighting against your species, but then you unify the whole species. And the next stage is intergalactic travel. And that's the stage that actually opens up your head as a gamer. Like, yo, what? And then if you compare it to the human story, we've just reached right outside of Pluto right now.
Yeah,
we don't even know what's out there.
Yes.
And in Spore, again, when you're an intergalactic being, there's lots of friendly ones, there's neutral ones, and there's aggressive ones. And the eventual aim of the game is to reach the center of the galaxy, which is like a PowerPoint. It's a source of power. It's a source of, I believe, food and all. There's some planets there which are like a source of food or galaxy, something like that. Source of minerals.
So it's a battle for resources of the galaxy.
Something like that.
I see.
Again, this is all just hypothesis. These are all just theories. This game, I spent hours on it just to reach the center of the galaxy, to maximize in each level, all that. Beautiful, beautiful exercise for the mind. The game flopped. There was never a sequel.
Really?
Yeah. Because they didn't execute well. They failed as a product, but they didn't fail as an idea.
The idea seems to be very great. Yeah.
What do you think is at the center of the Milky Way galaxy?
A supermassive black hole.
Okay.
We know it's there.
Okay.
Yeah, it's been observed. Its gravitational effects have been observed because you can see stars slinging around very fast around this black hole.
Before I ask you questions about black holes, I've got to ask you questions about your science fiction inspirations. So I would say for me, it's Spore, what I just spoke about. Arrival, which we also spoke about in this part, was Arrival blasted my head. So it's a very simple movie. Lots of people won't like the movie. The third one, I definitely say is Interstellar.
That's a great movie.
Oh.
Yeah.
And I know that Nolan consulted with physicists to create visualizations, to create the exact graphics. Even the climax of Interstellar, and spoiler alert, I think you've already spoken about in the podcast. Where he basically, Matthew McConaughey, passes through a black hole and he enters another dimension.
Yes.
Our dimension is x-axis, y-axis. Which means if I walk in a straight line, it's x-axis. If I walk sideways, it's y-axis. If I jump up, it's z-axis. That's it, the 3D creatures. He enters a dimension where there are more than just three axes. And that fourth one, he can't even explain. So his mind isn't able to perceive what's going on. But it's basically time travel. Is that considered the fourth axis?
Yeah, time is supposed to be the fourth dimension of space-time in general relativity. So time is the fourth dimension.
So when we say space, it is these three axes, X, Y, Z. Forward, sideways, jumping up.
Yes.
Or going down.
Yes.
And then the fourth one is time.
It's time.
Which means that, which year were you born in?
1976.
I can go back to 1976 right now because 1976 is happening at the same time as 2021. But our minds are only able to perceive 2021 as of now. Possibly because of the quantum physics theory that you stated that when you put your attention on something, it becomes a real thing.
It's a possibility.
I would actually love the physics expert to shed some light on these axes, time travel, and all these concepts.
So in general relativity, space-time is a four-dimensional arena that the entire universe is embedded in. Okay. So it's like a platform that you play in, but it has four dimensions. Now, time travel, I'm not sure if it is possible because it may break the causal structure of the universe. One of the possibilities of how to do time travel is the concept of the wormhole in which you go backward. You loop through something and you go back to another, not just a different place in the universe, but a different time in the universe.
Mm.
So that may break some causality laws of the universe. So we are not sure how that works. Okay. Stephen Hawking had proposed that it may not be allowed because it breaks causality. But that is just a conjecture. We don't have proof of that. So wormholes would be the best way to travel back or forward in time. Is it possible? It may be possible. We don't know yet. But talking about dimensions in string theory, for example, string theory doesn't work in 3 dimensions or 4 dimensions. To have a proper theory in which it works, you need 10 dimensions.
What is string theory? Can you explain it? Mm-hmm.
So string theory is it came out of the need to reconcile gravity with quantum theory. For example, quantum field theory, which I spoke about, it is all about fields. This theory doesn't work in curved space-time. In general relativity, matter curves space-time, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you try to use quantum field theory in that, it breaks down. So the mathematics breaks down.
One second. I gotta break it down way further for the listeners. So when you said matter curves space-time.
Okay, yes.
That basically means that, so they say that imagine space-time like a long bed sheet.
Like a long bed sheet, like a trampoline, like a long surface.
That's the
stretchable surface.
Okay, that's the arena you spoke about.
Yes.
And you're saying Manloa universe is like a ball.
Let's say the sun is a ball.
Okay, the sun is a ball.
So you put the sun on this arena, it will go down deep into that. It will stretch.
Okay.
And it will warp the entire surface. Mm. So if you have a smaller ball, which was earlier passing in a straight line, because of the presence of the sun, it will move in a curved line.
Got it. Mm.
And that's why you have these orbits around the sun. The planets go in orbits around the sun. So according to general relativity, matter warps space-time and it tells other matter how to move.
Got it.
Okay, so that is the concept of warping of space-time.
And that's where the concept of gravity also comes into play.
Gravity is nothing but the warping, the curvature of space-time. It is just a geometrical, it's an outcome of geometry. It emerges out of the geometry of space-time.
Let me take this a little deeper. Now, we think that the universe that we see around us, the stars, that blackness of space is all that there is. But there's actually something we possibly don't see, which is that space-time bedsheet that we spoke about. What's the official word for it?
Space-time.
Space-time.
That's it.
It's Manlo. It's like, I mean, just try assuming that it's like a, it's like a bedsheet.
Yeah.
We are not able to see that. The bigger the object, the more it has an impact on space-time.
Yes.
And therefore, if we're talking about the sun, which is so heavy, it has a huge impact on space-time.
It does, yes.
And it affects the smaller objects around it, which human minds understand as gravity. That, oh, here's a big object and that's why we are attracted to it or we orbit around it. But it possibly also has an impact on the human mind's perception of time. Am I right?
Yes. So time, space-time consists of time as well, right? So what happens in general relativity is that around a large object, time itself gets warped. Time itself slows down. So for example, sitting here on the surface of our planet, time moves at a certain speed.
Mm.
If you go 100 meters, 100 kilometers up into orbit, time is slightly faster. The difference is very, very little. Mm. But if you had a clock that was accurate enough, you would be able to measure the difference at the speed at which time travels.
Right.
Now, if you were to orbit around the sun close by, then time will move at a different speed. If you were to take an orbit around a big black hole, then for you, it may feel like it's been just 20 minutes, but on Earth, it will be 20 years.
Mm.
So that's the kind of effect that you see in general relativity. And this has been actually measured.
Which is what they show in Interstellar, where...
In Interstellar, they show that, yes.
Yeah, where he spends, I think, 1 hour or something of a short duration on a particular planet. And he comes back to his spaceship and he gets a message from his own daughter, who's now as old as him. He's like, whatever, 35, and now his daughter's also 35.
That's right.
She's spending time on Earth with the time phenomenon that we know on this planet. And he has gone on this other massive planet where time for him has slowed down a lot.
I think that planet was in orbit around a large black hole, and that's why time was slower.
Oh, okay. Got it. So what is your theory?
So friends, very intense topic. Some things were going on. When they said it, it was curved, and I said, और उसी टाइम उन्होंने रोक के फिर एक्सप्लेन किया. मैंने कहा अच्छा कुछ कुछ समझ में आ रहा है. और ये मूवीज जिसकी भी ये बात कर रहे हैं वो सब हमने देखी हुई है. ये अलग बात है कि मुझे याद नहीं आ रही इनकी स्टोरीज एग्जैक्टली. वो जो अराइवल है उसकी तो थोड़ी थोड़ी याद आ रही है कि लड़की जो होती है वही बातचीत करने की कोशिश करती है उसके साथ और पूरा मूवी में बस वही सीन होता है कि वो जा रही है, बात कर रही है, कोशिश कर रही है, फिर जा रही है, बात कर रही है, फिर कम्युनिकेशन शुरू होती है, उसके बाद मुझे याद नहीं क्या हुआ था, उसके बाद स्टोरी मेरे को याद नहीं है। और दूसरी वाली मूवी भी शायद मुझे लग रहा है मैंने देखी भी है, उसका कुछ भी याद नहीं है, वो मेरे ख्याल से खुद फिर से देखनी पड़ेगी क्योंकि उसमें ध्यान में कुछ नहीं आ रहा। पर इतना इंटरेस्टिंग इंटरेस्टिंग चीजें बता रहे हैं और इतनी कॉम्प्लेक्स चीजें हैं कि सोचते सोचते दिमाग खराब हो सकता है। क्योंकि मुझे याद है मैं तो ये तो बोले 10 dimensions, तो मैं ये याद कर रही थी कि जब फर्स्ट टाइम हमें फिजिक्स की क्लास में इंट्रोड्यूस किया था 3 dimensions, पहले तो 2 dimensions करते थे, जब 3 dimension हुआ था मैं इतनी कंफ्यूज हो गई थी कि मैंने टीचर को आगे जाने ही नहीं दिया। मेरे पूरे पीरियड में मेरी टीचर जो थी मुझे कोशिश करती रही क्लास के सामने समझाने की कि 3rd dimension कैसे दिखता है, तो मतलब यहां से बता रही थी, वॉल से बताने की उन्होंने कोशिश की, वो किया, पर मेरे से वो इमेजिन ही नहीं हो रहा था। फिर इवेंचुअली वो हार गई और फिर कहती है किसी और बच्चा था क्लास का, कहते अच्छा तुझे समझ में आ गया ना, क्लास के बाद तुम उसको समझा देना।
नहीं वो तो सिंपल एक क्यूब दिखा सकते थे बस।
हाँ पर इतना उस टाइम नया कॉन्सेप्ट लगा
कि क्लास में क्यूब तो होते हैं, किसी का भी लंच बॉक्स क्यूब दिखा के ही है 3 dimension।
हाँ पर उसमें मुझे फिर ये नहीं समझ में आता था कि 3 dimension में चीजें कैसे होती हैं, क्या होता है वो, मतलब कॉन्सेप्ट। तो मैं 10 dimension सोच के तो मैं कह रही थी कितना कॉम्प्लिकेटेड होगा, मैं इमेजिनेशन ही करना, क्योंकि आपको एक पॉइंट है उसको 3 dimension में कहाँ है वो इमेजिन करना, वो डिस्टेंस उसका निकालना, इतना वो लगता है 10 dimension में क्या होता होगा गॉड नोज, बट दिस इज रियली कॉम्प्लिकेटेड एंड वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग।
नहीं बहुत अच्छा था और स्पेशली फोकस था इंटरस्टेलर मूवी पे। अगर जो भी इंसान इंटरस्टेलर को देखता है पहले तो वो सोचता रहता है एक दिन तक काफी इंटेंस मूवी थी, काफी जबरदस्त मूवी थी। ऐसी कई मूवीज बनी है जिसमें उन्होंने रियल कॉन्सेप्ट्स दिखाए हैं साइंस के,
बहुत सारी।
उसके बाद जब आप देखने के बाद आप सोचते हैं कि मेरे को समझना चाहिए, क्योंकि ये बहुत ही एक्साइटिंग फिनोमिना था। फिर आप इंटरनेट में जाते हैं तो आपको कई आर्टिकल मिल जाते हैं एस्ट्रोफिजिक्स वगैरह के साथ, जो आपको थोड़ा डिटेल में समझाते हैं कि वो मूवी क्या बोल रही थी। फिर आप पढ़ते हैं आपको रियलिटी समझ आती है कि ह्यूमन ब्रेन अभी, मतलब ह्यूमंस जो हैं उन्होंने कुछ अचीव नहीं किया लाइफ में, बहुत ही छोटे हैं, बहुत सारी मिस्ट्रीज हैं जो अभी ह्यूमन बीइंग ने देखी नहीं है, और कुछ पता नहीं है लाइफ में कि बिग बैंग थ्योरी भी रॉन्ग हो सकती है। तो अभी जो जो पता है उसके हिसाब से इवॉल्व एवोल्यूशन चल रहा है, मगर एक समय पे जैसे आगे जाएंगे बहुत कुछ नया आएगा, आपको चीज़ें पता लगेंगी। और उसके बाद जो है आपको ये भी पता लगता है कि अगर आपने कभी वेदास पढ़े हैं, वेदास के बारे में पढ़े, उपनिषद पढ़े हैं, भगवद्गीता पढ़ी है, तो उसमें कुछ ऐसी बातें आते हैं आपको जगता है धीरे धीरे साइंस उसी बात तक पहुंच रहा है। जब वो कहते हैं कि आपका जन्म जो हो सकता है किसी और प्लैनेट में हो सकता है, उस प्लैनेट में जिसमें दिखाते हैं कि वहां पे पानी के बदले दूध की नदियां बह रही हैं, तो मतलब जैसे जैसे वो बोलते हैं कि तुम जिस डेमी गॉड को वर्शिप करते हो तुम उसके प्लैनेट में जाओगे, और दूसरे भगवत गीता के साथ से भगवान कृष्णा के प्लैनेट पे जाओगे अगर आप लॉर्ड कृष्णा के भक्त हैं, तो कुछ कुछ ऐसी बातें आपको नजर आती हैं कि उस समय जिसने लिखे थे उनको भी कॉन्सेप्ट्स कुछ पता थे अपनी मेडिटेशन की वजह से, उन्होंने मेडिटेट किया, उनको कुछ कनेक्टिविटी हुई हायर अथॉरिटी से, उनको कुछ नॉलेज आई, उन्होंने लिख दी एक बुक में, और हम जब देखते हैं तो हमें पता चलता है कि ग्रेटनेस उसमें लिखी हुई है। बहुत लोग तो मानते हैं ऐसे ही हैं, मगर जो लोग वाकई उसको देख रहे हैं और धीरे धीरे साइंस आपको चीज़ें बता रही है, तो आपको लगता है कि बहुत सारी नॉलेज थी वैदिक लोगों के पास। दुख की बात यह है कि फिर वो इतने फिलोसोफर्स जो इतनी मेडिटेट करते थे, ध्यान में जाते थे, वो कहीं चले गए, अब आपको नजर नहीं आते लोग जो इतनी जबरदस्त तपस्या कर सकते हैं, बहुत वो सब नहीं है कोई ऐसे जो अपने आप को सेपरेट कर सके अपनी बॉडी से। तो उस समय लोगों में पावर थी क्योंकि उस समय सही पाथ पे जा रहे थे, बड़ी बड़ी यूनिवर्सिटीज थी जहाँ पे रिसर्च होती थी। अब जो है मगर धीरे धीरे आपको साइंस वहीं लेके जा रही है एक डिफरेंट तरीके से, रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशन से। तभी कहते हैं कि टाइम ट्रैवल डिफिकल्ट है क्योंकि ब्रेक हो जाते हैं। कितनी सारी मूवीज बनी है कि टाइम ट्रैवल में, जिसमें हमेशा कुछ ना कुछ होता है कि टाइम ट्रैवल में जाए तो अपने आप को देख रहे हैं, मगर अगर उसने आपको देख लिया तो ये लॉज ऑफ फिजिक्स टूट जाएंगे, फिर अगर आप कुछ चेंज करते हैं तो पूरा थ्रेड चेंज हो जाता है आपका, आपके लोगों का, आप उस थ्रेड में नहीं है मगर आपका एक एंटिटी उस थ्रेड में रह रही है। तो मतलब वो सारे फिजिक्स से जनरेट हो रहे हैं, किसी को कुछ पता नहीं है, सिर्फ सोच रहे हैं कि ऐसा होता होगा ऐसा होता होगा। और तो मेरे ख्याल से काफी अच्छी बात हो रही है, काफी अच्छी बात करें। एलियंस का तो गारंटेड एलियंस है, सिर्फ ये कि हमारी रेंज बहुत छोटी है, हाई हम मिल्की वे में, हाई बहुत पीछे मिल्की वे में, पहली बात तो है सेंटर तो मिल्की वे में नहीं है, दूर है मिल्की वे में वहां से भी, और रीजन है कि हम वहां पे हैं जिससे दूर रहें आराम से। और लोग भी कहते हैं कहीं हो सकता है एलियंस आए, उन्हें देखा होगा बहुत प्रिमिटिव रेस है, अभी तक इसने कुछ अचीव नहीं किया, जाने दो जब ये आगे बढ़ जाएंगे तब देखेंगे। और कुछ लोग उसी इंटरप्रिटेशन को बोलते हैं कि हो सकता है भगवान थे वो, जिनको हम भगवान मानते हैं कि हमें किसी ने क्रिएट किया, कुछ भी हुआ, अगर आपको इतनी समझ नहीं है इसका मतलब कोई बहुत ही सुपीरियर बींग्स एग्जिस्ट करते हैं, उन सुपीरियर बींग्स ने हो सकता है कुछ चीजें प्रोड्यूस भी की हों, तो जो भी है इसमें काफी रहती है, ह्यूमन बींग्स को कभी पता नहीं चलेगा, एटलीस्ट हमारे समय तो पता नहीं लगा, मगर जैसे साइंस इवॉल्व हो रही है कुछ ना कुछ सामने आएगा। तो अच्छा वीडियो,
यस फ्रेंड्स, तो अभी शेखर अपने थॉट्स चलते हैं, मिलेंगे नेक्स्ट वीडियो में बहुत ही जल्द, टिल देन टेक केयर एंड बाय बाय।
तो अगर आप मेरे इस चैनल पे नए हो तो जल्दी से सब्सक्राइब के बटन को हिट करो और बेल आइकन को क्लिक करो ताकि आपको मेरा जब नया वीडियो मैं लगाऊं आपको उसके बारे में जल्दी से पता चल जाए।